Now, it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker. Dr. Nicholas Saunders is Professor of Material Culture in the Department of Anthropology and Archaeology at the University of Bristol. His main research interests are the archaeology and anthropology of 20th century conflict, particularly landscape, material culture, and cultural memory. He is co-director of the Great Arab Revolt Project in southern Jordan and the Isonzo Valley 1915-1918 Conflict Landscapes on the Slovenian-Italian Border Project. He has worked extensively on the material culture of the First World War in Belgium and France. His books include Killing Time, Archaeology in the First World War, The Poppy, A History of Conflict, Loss, Remembrance, and Redemption, Modern Conflict and the Senses, and most recently, Desert Insurgency, Archaeology, T.E. Lawrence, and the Arab Revolt. Friends, please welcome Dr. Saunders.
Thank you very much indeed. As long as this is all working now, I will start my lecture. And let me say at the outset, I'm honored and very pleased to be able to be with you this evening, or this evening and dark outside my house here in England, but maybe not where you are. So here we go. What I just need to do is get rid of that. Okay, so I think what I'd like to do for the next 45 minutes or so is to give you a flavor of the work that we did for the best part of 10 years and that finished in 2014. And it was an idea which we thought might not ever get off the ground because it was a new idea, even though the topic was a famous historical topic. Lawrence himself, of course, and the Arab Revolt, 1916, 1918. But the idea of doing archaeology of this was indeed very, very new. So we decided to sort of be fairly open-ended about this, and we put together a team, mainly of volunteers, and spent the next 9 years in the desert doing this work, doing this research and field work, but also then at the end of the day writing the normal popular and academic scientific articles and several monographs as well. So let me take you back 100 years, and then we'll gradually work up to the field work that we did and show you some of the things that we discovered, much to our surprise, and much to the surprise of our Jordanian colleagues who had also not really given much time and interest to this particular topic, mainly because they had a wealth of Roman, Byzantine, Nabataean Muslim archaeology and really didn't have the bandwidth available at that time to look at something less than 100 years old. So, yeah, hold on. Yeah, here we go. So this was basically a 10-year project in what we call, or what is now known as, modern conflict archaeology, mainly to separate it out, I suppose, from more traditional battlefield archaeology. And from the very beginning, it was a blend of different disciplines and different intellectual interests. So we were basically archaeologists, but we also did anthropology. Cultural and military history played an important role, museology, heritage, tourism. And in terms of our sort of intellectual, scientific, academic engagement with these various interesting aspects was the topic of landscape. We looked at landscape, we looked at material culture, remote sensing imagery to a certain extent, though I must say at the outset that we did not have access at that point to drone technology and all of the wonderful things that can be done nowadays. And of course, archive work, archives of documentation and significantly of private photographs and institutional photographs of this period. So we were trying to do a whole range of things with this project, which had never been done before on this topic in this area. And my particular book is this one on the screen. Although my co-director did an earlier book on the history, mine was essentially the archaeology. So when we started, we thought we'd probably be spending maybe 3 years looking at the abandoned railway stations of the Hejaz Railway, which ran from Damascus in in Syria south and to Medina in what is now Saudi Arabia. And we thought that's probably what we would be doing. But in actual fact, within a few hours of our arrival in the area that we were investigating, we decided we had to completely redraw a lot of the things that we were expecting to be doing. And one of the things we realized that we were doing, of course, was trying to create an archaeology of modern guerrilla warfare. Guerrilla warfare is millennia old, but modern guerrilla warfare was a very different thing indeed. And right from the outset, the influence of Lawrence of Arabia, T.E. Lawrence, was there in his famous, some would say infamous book, Seven Pillars of Wisdom. And he actually captured the essence of this by saying, suppose we were, as we might be, an influence, an idea, a thing intangible, invulnerable, no front or back, drifting about like a gas. Armies were like plants, immobile as a whole and firm-rooted. We might be a vapor blowing where we listed. And this was the essence of all guerrilla warfare, but particularly modern guerrilla warfare. And it soon became apparent to us that that is what we were doing. We were struggling to create an archaeology of the Arab Revolt as a modern guerrilla conflict. These maps basically show the area that we were working in. You can see on the left-hand side the beginnings of the Hejaz Railway in the north, just south of Beirut in Damascus, all the way down to Medina in Saudi Arabia. And the geopolitical strategic significance of this area is evident today on our news every day. And you can see partly the reason why, because it's parallels to a large extent the Red Sea. And this, of course, is a topic of strategic importance today. On the right-hand side, you can see the area of the Hejaz Railway from Damascus down to the southern border of Jordan. And we were working essentially from about four-fifths of the way down at a place called Ma'an and all the way down to the border. We didn't cross the border. We wanted to, but we couldn't in those days. And so that was just over 100 kilometers, 60 miles or so. So it took us about the best part of 10 years to do archaeological survey and excavation of round about 60 miles. So goodness knows what is beyond the border with Saudi Arabia. Down to Medina itself. Many, many things, as one can imagine. The backbone of our research was the Hejaz Railroad, which was built between 1900 and 1908. It was originally intended to go all the way down to Mecca to facilitate the Hajj pilgrimage, but for a variety of reasons, not including the hostility of the local Bedouin that far south, it had to end at Medina. So it never made its way all the way down to Mecca. What we see here on the top left is the actual construction going through the desert. And on the right-hand side, you can see an area, a relatively small area of reconstructed railroad from the 1970s, because at that point, Jordan discovered phosphate, and that became a major part of the Jordanian economy. And so a small part of the original railroad was rebuilt, as you can see there, but the route is the same. And on the left, at the bottom, you can see what was left of the Hejaz Railway near to Saudi Arabia when, after the Arab Revolt in the late 1920s, let's say, this area was taken up, the rails were taken up and sold off or just stolen, leaving the embankment. And that's what you can see there, the original embankment from 1905, 1906 in this particular area. And I'll be coming back to that. One of the big things which we discovered and which we grappled with trying to understand at the beginning was the fact that we were finding dozens and dozens, eventually over 100, campsites in the desert. And these were arranged arranged in parallel rows for the workers who were constructing the railroad. And you can see Google Earth images here. One, two, several of these parallel rows of tent rings. And that's all that's left today. And originally, of course, we thought this was probably something to do with the Arab Revolt, which is why we were there. But it soon became apparent that this was not the case, and that well over 100 of these were just the remnants of the construction process and moving north to south, and essentially just finding a tented home for the workers whilst they were building the nearby stretch and bridges and culverts and laying the track, and then moving south and building another campsite and so on and so forth. So this was something which is completely new to us. Nobody we talked to seemed to know anything about it, although there were may well have been specialists around the world whom we were unaware of. But nobody could help us, so we had to kind of teach ourselves about what was going on here. And this is what one of these campsites looks like. They altered differently, or they look different according to the geology that the railroad passed through. This particular area had large stones available for anchoring down the bell tents where the laborers worked. And so you can see a whole row of these things. And the local Bedouin called this the bird's nest. And so we took that name as the bird's nest construction camp on the way down to Mecca. And this is what one of these construction camps would have looked like at the time, between 1900 and 1908. Most of the laborers were, in fact, a special railway battalion raised in Damascus by the Ottomans to help build the railroad. They weren't, strictly speaking, soldiers, trained soldiers, but they did form a railway battalion, and they were given uniforms and equipment, which was identical to official Turkish Ottoman soldiers. So that was a challenge to us to be able to identify and discriminate between finding things which were identical to other things, but which were, in fact, quite different. In other words, was this a laborer's camp or was it a soldier's camp? And so we began to learn how to read the desert in that particular sense. So this is what we thought that we would be doing, looking at the railway stations built in the desert, what we see in the top is essentially under construction in the early 1900s of a Hejaz railway station and the railroad tracks in front of it. And on the bottom left, a reconstructed one of these, which you can see if you look closely, you can see the holes in the wall. Essentially, this was a loophole for being able to poke out a rifle and shoot at the local Bedouin if they attacked. And on the right-hand side at the bottom is you see the remains of one of these stations, buildings, which had new holes poked through it once the Arab Revolt had begun, when the threat was far more serious than the occasional Bedouin raid. And so the loopholes had to be larger and bigger and more frequent. And this was what one of these abandoned station buildings at a place called Wadi Rutum looked like in around about 2005, 2006. We soon began to realize, of course, that we were not just doing archaeology and trying to create, I suppose, an archaeology of modern guerrilla warfare, but we were also dealing with anthropology, we were also dealing with heritage, we were also dealing with Hollywood, we were dealing with Lawrence and Seven Pillars of Wisdom, and we were dealing specifically, I suppose, with David Lean's Lawrence of Arabia Hollywood epic, and the effect that this has had on popular understanding of the Arab Revolt and this part of the world when it comes to the First World War. So what we have at the top left is the image from Lawrence of Arabia film, the iconic blowing up of the Turkish train. And what we have on the right-hand side at the top are some actual fragments of railroad track which have been blown up by Lawrence and by the British and the Bedouin during the Arab Revolt, and which we encountered. And on the bottom left, we see the actual site of the ambush, which is depicted in the film still above it, which we were allowed to survey and to investigate. Although it was in a no man's land on the border between Jordan and Saudi Arabia, and we had to have a kind of a bodyguard from the Jordanian army with us. And on the right hand side at the bottom, you have this whole confusion of tourism and the mishmash of inaccurate history in terms of academic military history about what actually happened, and the way that this is transformed and used for heritage and tourism. So what we see here basically is a reconstruction, a piece of railway which was never there in the Arab Revolt, and the a train and some carriages, and tourists pay, don't know, $20, $30 maybe. And the train goes backwards and forwards over a mile or so and gets attacked by local Bedouin guys dressed up as Turkish soldiers. And it's all great fun. And the really interesting thing is that there was no Hejaz Railway here at that time. It's a total fiction. But it did give us a clue into, you know, how tenacious the mythology and the oral tradition and the different attitudes and views of local people and tourists were concerning the Arab Revolt, Lawrence of Arabia, the history, and Lawrence of Arabia, the film. One of the things which really astounded us was the preservation that we found in the desert. Nobody had really looked at the archaeology of the Arab Revolt ever since it had occurred. There's just no interest in it whatsoever. But aerial photographs, unfortunately not drone photographs, but aerial photographs, did show some amazing locations with extraordinary trench lines, which we can see there on the right-hand side, Ottoman trenches at the big railway hub of the Hejaz Railway, and a place at the place called Ma'an. And we spent several years investigating these trenches. And this was one of the redoubts that we surveyed and excavated in great depth. On the top of a hill, going down the slope is to the top of the slide. And this was the area which was attacked, but repulsed. The Arabs, the Bedouin, attacked uphill, but were repulsed by the Turks. And that was the first, virtually the first and last time that the British, Lawrence, the Bedouin, in various formations, ever tried to attack a Turkish fortified position. That was not the strength of guerrilla warfare, and they learned that to their cost and almost never really repeated that mistake. When we were working there, of course, we were working in the present, 2006, 7, 8, 9. And at that time, there were all kinds of things going on in Iraq with the coalition forces and Saddam Hussein. And so we were, every day it depended on what was happening in Baghdad as to what would be our situation over the border in Jordan. Sometimes it was friendly and absolutely fine, which is most of the time. But on a particularly bad day in Baghdad, it could be slightly trickier. And so what we had on this particular day was a visit from the Jordanian army in an American Humvee armored vehicle parked, although the soldier wasn't aware of it, parked on the original Ottoman trenches from the First World War, which was in essence the origin of the Jordanian army itself. One of the things which we tried to do from the beginning was to to embed ourselves as much as possible with local people, local communities. And here we had a visit from local school children and giving them a talk in Arabic about what we were doing, excavating on this site at Ma'an Station. The interesting thing is that they were interested. They thought it was very strange that we would be doing such a thing and coming from all over the world in a multinational team to dig these holes. And of course, you know, it must have been at the end of the day that we were looking for gold, Turkish gold, which it was almost impossible to dissuade them that was not the case at all. And we found that many times in our 10 years or so of working in southern Jordan. And there is a whole variety of reasons as to why that could be. And that in itself would be a kind of an hour and a half presentation. Of course, what we found in the desert was not the deep stratigraphy of, say, the Western Front or the European Front, or even the Eastern Front. But we were looking really at not vertical stratigraphy, but horizontal stratigraphy, very ephemeral remains of a confrontation that might have lasted 10 minutes or an hour and a half, and then never came back to that position. And so the kinds of things we found were very different from what traditional battlefield archaeology and traditional archaeology itself with deep stratigraphy had to engage with. We soon began to recognize some of the diagnostic kinds of material culture, the different Ottoman crescent, star and crescent uniform buttons that we found hundreds of examples of. And the better educated Ottoman officers had seal rings for their orders, almost in a sort of a medieval fashion, which you can see there in the middle at the bottom. What we were quite amazed at, really, I suppose, over the 10 years was the sheer degree of fortification of the areas adjacent to the Hejaz Railroad. Most people had thought, well, there were stations, and sometimes these stations were fortified to a greater or lesser extent. What they hadn't realized, and what is now totally realized and understood, is that there's this vast area of landscape flanking both sides of the railroad out there in the desert, which were essentially Ottoman fortifications thrown up quite quickly but quite effectively in order to forestall guerrilla raids on the railway itself. There was this whole hidden landscape that we gradually realized was there and then spent years investigating. And this is just one example of an Ottoman redoubt down near the border with Saudi Arabia. And many of these locations, of course, were not known to the British or the French at the time of the Arab Revolt, mainly because they didn't know that they were there. And the reason they didn't know is because that they weren't manned. There were no giveaway white Ottoman army tents because the Ottomans were incredibly short of manpower. And so what they did was they built a landscape of fortifications, but they shuffled through this small number of troops that they had as and when they needed to in pre-prepared fortified locations. So when the Royal Flying Corps and Royal Air Force planes flew over trying to spot where Ottoman forces might be, they, of course, they looked for the giveaway white Ottoman army tents. And if there were no army tents there, they guessed that there were no soldiers there. And so they didn't need to report this location to Lawrence and the Bedouin and the French forces. This was another thing which we gradually learned as we surveyed and annotated and investigated many of these sites. Within the area that we investigated, we identified, after many years, we identified local areas that had been fortified, small militarized landscape areas. And this was probably the one that we spent most time on, which was like halfway down from Ma'an down to the Saudi border at a place called, essentially, I suppose, Batan Al Ghul, which was a station, totally disappeared now. And it was the area where the railway went from the high stony desert plateau, as you can see at the top of this map, down a steep slope and then down a desert wadi and then south down to the Saudi Arabia border. And we spent a lot of time surveying and excavating and trying to read this landscape. And what we did find, I think, at the end of the day was a very sophisticated use of the landscape by the Ottomans, who had to fortify this area with a relatively small number of men to man these various locations as and when it was needed. And this is an aerial photograph, not the drone photograph, a helicopter photograph of that same of this same area, basically taken from the place called Fasua Ridge in the middle of the map there, looking south down towards Saudi Arabia. It's a very, very dramatic landscape, and easy to see how it becomes sort of romanticized or over-romanticized in the Western imagination, fed, of course, or accelerated, of course, by the film Lawrence of Arabia. And this was Wadi Rutum. This was the abandoned, partly destroyed station, mainly destroyed as we see it here, which was a stopping place for the Hejaz Railway as it was going south. It was attacked by the British and the Bedouin on several occasions, and bombed by the Royal Air Force as well. And this was about half a mile away from that station. And it was our first army camp. This was a Turkish, professional Turkish army camp, rather than one of these much larger labor construction camps from a few years before, which we spent a lot of time surveying and excavating. And one of the ways in which we kind of spent time trying to understand the logistics of how the Ottomans dealt with the lack of manpower and how they defended these areas out in the desert as effectively as possible was an area which we called the Fasua Ridge sector. And they evidently used large numbers of mules to connect up these isolated desert spots and locations. And you can see there a mule trough of the stones where they had the food and the water, and then the crescent of white sand was where the mules would stand, and without sort of damaging their feet too much. And on the right-hand side at the bottom are the mule shoes, which was a giveaway. I'll leave that one. We found all kinds of material culture and bits and pieces and things which you might not necessarily have thought to find. Like, say, on the bottom left here, we have very fragile cigarette papers and packets, cardboard, from the Ottoman soldiers, officers, possibly, during the Arab Revolt itself. And so here we have a make which is from Istanbul. On the right at the bottom, we have a cutthroat razor. Above it, we have curiously exploded pants. And on the top left, we have, bearing in mind our origin as a project at the University of Bristol, the top of a tobacco tin made by a company in Bristol, the building of which is still there today. And it was kind of curious that we come all the way from Bristol University to the desert in the south of Jordan to find bits of material culture made in Bristol. Various Ottoman buttons, officers' matrix, exploded munitions, though nowhere near as many as one finds on the Western Front. And examples, intriguing examples of Ottoman early 20th century material culture items, spoon, button, star and crescent button, a padlock, and a Neolithic millennia old stone tool, prehistoric stone tool. These things which were collected by these soldiers stuck out in the middle of nowhere, always being worried about being attacked by the British and the Bedouin from who knows which direction. And they spent time looking around and collecting prehistoric artifacts. And then when they had to leave, they just left them with their own modern objects. And this is one of the particularly interesting things, I think, that we found was that the Hejaz Railway, which everybody knew was following the line of the Hajj route of horses and camels before steam railways came along. But of course, before that, it went back into Byzantine, Roman, Nabatean, prehistoric times. And so we were actually in a landscape which was millennia old, even though we were only investigating things which were a century old. But we did find things from earlier peoples who had gone up and down this route. And we investigated, we encountered, by luck actually, Bedouin who were moving their herds down this route of the railway, but which was really a prehistoric routeway. And they had their goats and camels, and we sort of photographed them and followed them down. They were using exactly the same routeway that had been used for thousands of years. To what extent they knew that or realized that, or it was just tradition, we don't know. But this anthropological oral tradition, of course, was a major aspect of our project. It wasn't just archaeology and excavation and military history. We were very much interested in the Arab Revolt in the oral tradition, the idea of the railway and the stations in terms of mythology, and what the Arabs actually thought. And we interviewed various people, including sheikhs and ordinary individuals, Arab individuals. And we found, for example, because people always ask, well, what did they think of Lawrence of Arabia? And I can honestly say that it was almost 50-50. Half of the people said, we were really proud. My great granddad, my great uncle rode with Lawrence of Arabia in a revolt, and it was brilliant. And the other half would say, well, he was a terrible and imperial agent selling the Arabs down the river, and we hate him. And it probably was 50-50 at the end of the day. And so we never actually knew until we started talking to people what their particular view of Lawrence of Arabia and his role in the Arab revolt and afterwards actually was. We tried to investigate things which had never been found before, and which we thought we probably wouldn't be able to. But this was searching for a very ephemeral, short-lived Royal Flying Corps, Royal Air Force canvas aerodrome used by the British aeroplanes to bomb the Ottoman stations and the Hejaz Railroad itself. And so we would interview with old photographs the local sheikh and local Bedouin. And this was the photograph that we were trying to track down. And it took us a while, several years. The giveaway here is that these are canvas hangars for biplanes that were used in the Arab Revolt. But luckily, the giveaway eventually turned out to be that curious geological formation in the background, which is where we actually traced it to eventually. And then we surveyed this site and found remains which confirmed that this was, in fact, where just for a few months the Royal Air Force had used to land and take off and bomb the Hejaz Railway. And so there you see the two together. There's been a lot of geographical change, water level and everything else, but the geology doesn't lie, and neither did the archaeology. But the biggest, and where I will sort of wrap up here, the biggest thing that I suppose that we discovered was the place which we eventually called Tooth Hill, and which you can see here. This was a photograph of a Rolls-Royce armored car raiding party getting ready to attack a Hejaz railway station defended by the Ottomans in April 1918, and trying to relocate this took a large amount of time, effort, luck. The Bedouin were of no value in this at all. We had to do this on our own. But you can see there the armored cars, the armored car tenders getting ready to attack. And we eventually, against all the odds, managed to relocate this place. And this is the photograph we took immediately, that we were standing in the same place as the photographer 100 years before. And as we walked towards that tooth-shaped hill, hence the name, we came across a campsite, which it looked as if Lawrence and his mates had left just a few days before. And this was extraordinary because Lawrence himself wrote, "We slept there that chilly night, happy with bully beef and tea and biscuits, with English talk and laughter around the fire, golden with its shower of sparks from the fierce brushwood." A very literary, typically Lawrence description of what we actually found. It was probably our Tutankhamun moment. It was the most amazing discovery. And we found all the things that one would normally expect to find in a European First World War location. Rum jars and bullet casings, bully beef tins, glass, and the remains of Rolls-Royce armored car, spark plugs and hawsers, all of this stuff. It was absolutely extraordinary. And we surveyed it and we excavated it totally, because we knew that one day it would, if it got out, that the people would come along and the whole thing would be cleared by looters. And so we had to sort of excavate it scientifically so that we could publish it and hand over all the material to the Jordanian government. And of course, at the time and since, it's become quite interesting to see how the effects, well, not the effects, the practice of guerrilla warfare as perfected by Lawrence and others, not just him, with Rolls-Royce armored cars and other armored vehicles, was used subsequently in various other guerrilla wars of the 20th century, and in this same area, 100 years later, by Islamic State, who, if you may recall, in 2014, made extraordinary gains by employing a few armed soldiers on fast-moving pickup trucks, basically the same techniques as Lawrence had used. And indeed, in Afghanistan and Iraq, the book of Seven Pillars of Wisdom that Lawrence wrote about his time in the Arab Revolt was used and is used and is known by terrorists and counterinsurgency American troops, American generals, British generals, because it gives insights into insurgency and counterinsurgency. And for a few months back in 2014, ISIS, Islamic State, used this to great, great effect. And I'll finish on this one. Well, this is the penultimate one. One of the things that we did find, of course, was that even when we first arrived, this amazing heritage, largely unknown desert heritage, was being damaged and looted for gold, which was a complete obsession. And so here we have an Ottoman tent ring with a gold digger's hole right in the middle of it. And kind of summing that up, which is the advantages and the disadvantages and the tragedies and the extraordinary achievements of the Arab Revolt, is this, really, I suppose. For the relatively small outlay of 200,000 English pounds per month in British gold, plus some equipment and liaison personnel, it was the official view, British view, was that it was money well spent. £6 million for 30 months activity. And then you compare that with US expenditure of $1.7 trillion for Syria and Iraq up to 2013. And $115 billion for Afghanistan, 2001 to 2015. And, of course, you come back to the same issues of the sheer cost of war and the sheer amount of time and effort and expertise that goes into creating war, and just how much money ordinary people through taxes have to pay for this. one of the things which I think we were proud of at the end of the day is we were looking at the human side, bringing back a voice to the British, the French, the Bedouin, the Ottomans themselves, which had basically been hidden for 100 years. And so we tried to bring back that voice and present this hidden episode and its landscape to the world. And so hopefully that's like giving you a flavor of that this evening. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saunders. Now, friends, this is the opportunity, if you haven't done so already, to type your questions into the chat or the Q&A box, both of which are on the bottoms of your screen. So, Dr. Saunders, let's begin with this first question. You briefly mentioned that this particular project was modern conflict archaeology rather than battlefield archaeology. Could you clarify the difference between the two?
Yes, of course. Battlefield archaeology, I suppose, has been the main way of looking at these things up until the late, I don't know, maybe around about 2000, something like that, on the back of some absolutely brilliant work by an American archaeologist, Douglas Scott, on the Battle of Little Bighorn. That was brilliant work, but what happened subsequently was anybody thought that they could do that by going out, digging holes, finding bullets, and finding bodies, and that became, unfortunately, labelled as battlefield archaeology. Well, when my colleagues and I, back in 2004, 2005, decided we might want to do something like this, we thought, well, one of the things we have to do is make this modern, scientific, interdisciplinary, anthropological, and take notice of art and culture and heritage and tourism and all of these things. And, of course, Hollywood for our particular project, to make this an interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary endeavor, an anthropological archaeology of recent conflict of the last 100 years. First World War, Arab Revolt, Second World War, Korea, whatever. And so that was the essential difference. It was, as we saw it, it was a complex century of complex warfare, which needed a sophisticated approach, not just go out in the field, dig some holes, find some bullet casings, maybe some bodies, and say, hey, job done.
Our next question. How did you confirm that the Hejaz construction camps were indeed for construction workers of the railway and not combatants involved in the Arab Revolt?
Yes, that was a good question, because we started off with that misapprehension, thinking that that's what we were finding, that we were finding Ottoman army soldiers' camps. But gradually we began to realize that this was completely untrue. First of all, the Ottomans didn't have enough men to build and man these during the Arab Revolt. It was a huge undertaking, which was only possible as part of the construction, the pre-First World War construction of the Hejaz Railroad itself, where there was lots of time, effort, money, expertise. And this is where the people were living as they moved north down to south. Also, there was very little evidence of defense, because who were they defending against apart from the odd raid by Bedouins? Whereas in the Arab Revolt, of course, it was completely different. The defenses needed to be large and strong to protect the Ottomans and the railway against the British, their air force, artillery, armored cars, Bedouins with firearms. And so it soon became evident to us that what we were doing was in fact tracking the progress across the landscape of the construction teams and material culture we found there. For example, one small example would be we found tags to bags of concrete. Concrete that was brought in for the construction of some of the bridges and the culverts and this sort of thing, which, you know, during the few years of the Arab Revolt, there was no time for that at all. That was impossible. So, you know, we came to realize that what we were doing was two things. We were there to investigate the Arab Revolt landscape, but we were discovering a pre-Arab Revolt landscape of the railway construction.
A lot of layers in that region, it seems.
Indeed, for such a small surface depth, there are many, many layers, yeah.
Merlin Dorfman asks, what was the main purpose of the Hejaz Railway? Why was it built?
Yeah, the main purpose of that was, well, there were several aspects to it. It was built on the command of the Sultan, the Ottoman Sultan Abdulhamid II, who thought that, well, it would be pretty good for him and his reputation and his ideas of his standing in the Muslim world if he could make access to Mecca much easier, much safer, and much cheaper and much quicker than the normal traditional Hajj pilgrimage, which was on donkeys and walking mainly, and horseback and some camels. And it was a very dangerous undertaking. It took about 40 days. And, you know, good Muslims want to do this, but it was very dangerous and very expensive to do. He thought it would be great for him and his reputation if he built the railway and people could go and it would take a couple of days. And they could go relatively cheaply and it would be safe because the Ottoman army would be on the train. And so he would become, you know, the hero of the Islamic world by facilitating the Hajj for ordinary people, not just those who could afford lots and lots of protection. So for the people who wanted to go on the Hajj, who came from Egypt and Syria and Turkey, that route became the Hajj route. And he decided that, you know, round about 1900, just before 1900, that if we built one of these wonderful new Western things called a railway, you know, everybody could hop on board and get down there really quick, really safe, really cheaply. And he would reap the benefits and the kudos of being a hero of the Islamic world.
Thank you. How does the desert climate impact the preservation of artifacts? With this being a much drier region, do artifacts fare better here than, say, the Western Front, which has much more moisture and vegetation?
Yes and no, I think is the answer. As frustrating as that is, on the Western Front, you have great depth with the vertical stratigraphy, but it does mean that things get protected under, you know, 6 inches, 6 feet of soil. Sometimes it's also flooded, which means it gets preserved in that kind of anaerobic atmosphere, which you don't get in Jordan. What you do get in Jordan, as you pointed out, was extremely dry, arid conditions. And so while the depth is very small and the stratigraphy is horizontal, and you do get wind and blowing and all of this, and sometimes you get flash floods, by and large, things just stay there under stones, under some sand, and they survive amazingly well. And we found vast amounts of paperwork. Which had just been there for 100 years. And despite the fact that you do get torrential rain now and again, you know, it had survived amazingly, which would never happen on the surface, shall we say, in the Western Front. But of course, it might happen on the Western Front 3 feet down. So it's kind of what we say, six of one and half a dozen of the other.
Incredible. To build upon a question asked by Bill Hamilton, are all of the material objects you uncovered now with the Jordanian government?
No, we managed to arrange for a museum exhibition in England. And then up until recently, we managed to, well, a lot of that material was taken to Belgium. because they had a big exhibition and big series of conferences and lectures there on the First World War in the Middle East. And of course, this is unique material. Nobody's ever come up with this kind of material before. So they arranged with a museum in England myself and my co-director to take some of this material and display it. And I think it came to an end a few months ago and has now been returned to the museum here. And in fact, that question is quite timely, because in the next couple of weeks, I have to go to the museum storerooms and arrange for it to all be sent back to the Department of Antiquities in Amman.
Kevin Boatride asks, what is the attitude of the Saudi and Jordanian governments towards your research?
That is a really, really interesting question. In Jordan, they gave us permission to do virtually anything we wanted to, because they hadn't really heard of something called modern conflict archaeology before. And they weren't particularly interested, mainly because they just have a wealth of astonishing archaeology there. Ancient Greek cities, ancient Roman cities, Roman roads, fortresses from Islamic fortresses. They have Petra, other Nabataean sites, prehistoric sites of 1 million, 2 million years old. There's just no time, no bandwidth available for something which is 100 years old. And so we were allowed to basically do what we wanted to do, on the understanding that anything we did find, obviously, would end up with the Department of Antiquities at the end of the day. In Saudi Arabia, where back then we were hoping to be able to move the project into Saudi Arabia, those were different days, and it was impossible. We couldn't even get across the border. Even the Bedouins sometimes have problems crossing that border. And we were told that when we were working in no man's land, that we had to keep our heads down because the Saudi border guards might take pot shots at us as well. So it was a very different world in Saudi Arabia then than today. Today it's completely different. The idea of archaeology, heritage, tourism, writing books, having Western academics and scientists teach and train Saudi Arabian people how to look after their own heritage, that is a revolution that is ongoing today as we speak, and there are several projects in the air which may land at some point about doing the kind of work that we did in Jordan but along the Hejaz Railway in Saudi Arabia. So we're kind of keeping our fingers crossed that one of these projects might come to fruition. But for the whole period that we were in Jordan, it was an impossibility.
Connor McNamee and Dave Marshall both ask, which of your findings was the most surprising?
I suppose the initial realization that in the first 2 hours of our first day back in 2006 out in the desert, that our idea of looking at and investigating some ruined Hejaz railway stations was not where it was at all. Where it was at was out in the desert, and we had to go and find it. We had no idea it could be there, or where it was, or how much of it there was. And how we would change a 3-year, very focused project into what turned out to be a 10-year project with many different focal points. And all the things which I've described, each one was astonishing. But I think that first one, we were expecting to see something, and we discovered by accident something utterly different, which changed the whole rate of engagement with the material, our ability to get out there, our ability to work safely there, and to bring and train people there, and to give talks to local museum, well, local universities, all of that became something which we had to start dealing with immediately. When basically we thought we'd be doing a bit of excavation in some buildings. So that was the big, huge gear change. And everything else that I've talked about, you know, came from that.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Saunders, I do want to be respectful of your time. We are at the top of the hour, but you are getting so much praise in the chat and a few more questions. Would you be amenable to staying on for maybe another 5 or 10 minutes to answer these last remaining questions?
Absolutely.
Wonderful. And friends, if you need to leave, no worries. This conversation will be recorded and available on our YouTube channel within the next week or so. So thank you for joining us. And for those of you who want to stay on to listen to the rest of this extended Q&A session, please feel free to do so. So our next question from Joe O'Farrell. He says, Nicholas, thanks for a magnificent presentation. My question is, as part of your research into Lawrence's guerrilla tactics, did he learn anything from the Irish guerrilla leader, Michael Collins, in the Irish attempt to secure independence from Britain in the 1920s?
That's a good question, and it probably, unfortunately, should have been directed to my co-director, who sadly passed away a couple of years ago, because he had Irish ancestry, and he was particularly interested in that aspect of the project, and that sort of aspect of what happened subsequently to the Arab Revolt. So, and he would have been able to answer that much better than I do. As far as I'm aware, in terms of my archaeological engagement with it, I've come across very little. But that doesn't mean that there wasn't. And of course, Lawrence himself had an Irish ancestry. So you have to bear in mind, I suppose, at the end of the day, in terms of trying to give a sensible answer to that, but, you know, in Ireland, the situation unfolded in the 20s. We're talking about 1916, 1917, 1918. So what Lawrence was theorizing, what he was writing down in Seven Pillars of Wisdom, what he was learning and passing on to his superiors in the British Army, was coming straight out of Bedouin practice in the desert in 1917 and 1918. The relationship with Ireland in the 1920s, by that time, you know, it had been done. His ideas had been formulated. His articles of guerrilla warfare had been written. I feel sure that he must have had really interesting discussions based on that question. But as far as my work is concerned, it had all been done before that happened.
Kevin Winter asks if you could expand a bit on the role of Neil Faulkner and John Winterburn during the GARP project.
Yes, Neil Faulkner, who was the person I mentioned just now, sadly died a couple of years ago, and myself were joint directors of the project. We sat down in 2004, 2005, and came up with the idea that this is the kind of thing that we wanted to do. Neil was an expert in Roman archaeology, published many books, done many excavations. What I brought to the table was the modern conflict anthropological dimension of it. And we got on extremely well and decided to create what we call an interdisciplinary approach to doing something like this. Although I must stress that we had no idea how rich what we would discover was going to prove to be at all. Nothing like that at all. I was then fortunate enough because at Bristol University, we had a whole batch of great postgraduate students, one of whom was this chap, John Winterburn, who was, I think, more or less same age as myself. And he came to me and wanted to do a PhD and be part of the Great Arab Revolt project. So it was absolutely perfect, because he was very much into techie stuff, which was not my strong point at all. He was very clued up on landscape, and he wanted to put all of that in a framework which would lead to a PhD. So he came along as a member of the team for, I think, all of the project. And it was, in fact, basically John Winterburn and myself who did most of the sort of landscape walking and exploring, whilst Neil, luckily we could rely on Neil to sort out all the excavation and the surveying back at site, different sites we were working with, and our volunteers. So it was kind of three of us in that particular way. And I can't really see that that project would have happened if it hadn't been for Neil Faulkner. And it certainly wouldn't have taken on the interdisciplinary flavor that it did if it hadn't been for John Winterburn. So absolutely.
Susan Vincent asks if you could explain why there seems to be two Lawrence Wells and which is the correct one and where.
One was they're both in Wadi Rum, which is the great Bedouin and tourist location. Lawrence was there, but there was never any real fighting there, and it wasn't a great area of the Arab Revolt's conflict that we were involved with investigating and that I've been talking about. But there's lots of places there which they say since, I don't know, so tourism, they're taken off in the 60s and 1970s in particular, and all of a sudden there were these amazing places there which were given the name of Lawrence. Lawrence's house, Lawrence's well, Lawrence's well number two. Lawrence walked this way, Lawrence walked backwards that way, Lawrence fell over here, but he did get up again and walk away, and so you kind of, it's a very, very interesting anthropology of modern myth making, manifested in different features of the actual landscape. So it's a really interesting mix of reality and imagination interfered with by Hollywood as well, which we could talk about for hours. So there is a place in not that far away. They're not that far away from each other, but there is a place in Wadi Rum, which is, I think, agreed by most academics and specialists that this was where Lawrence called the spring water. Then there is a completely different place, which is the one where many, not all, but many tourists who sign up for a Wadi Rum holiday exploration in Lawrence's footsteps get taken to, and which is not, as far as we are aware, one that Lawrence was aware of or visited or used. But, you know, if you think about it, it's kind of quite interesting that it's so potent as an idea, that the idea of Lawrence and then the revolt and the things which were true and the things which are completely fiction, blend in to a single landscape. And then people leave and they say, you know, I think I've gone to the wrong well. Or why was I taken to the wrong well? And so on and so forth. So, you know, it lives on.
And then our closing question, which summarizes quite a few questions that were asked, is, could you speak more to the experience of exploring the archaeology of modern conflict in the middle of an active conflict?
Yeah, that was something which was really interesting to me. And I had long conversations with Neil Faulkner about that, particularly in the first couple of years. When, as I mentioned briefly, we arrived to do the archaeology of the Arab Revolt 100 years before, but found ourselves daily having to think about what was the news coming out of Baghdad. And if it was bad news, if There'd been some terrible fight, and the Americans were being blamed for killing these guys, or these guys were being blamed for killing Americans, or whatever it was. You know, the border isn't that far away. And we could find, on one day, we would have school children and people coming up and asking us, what were we doing? Oh, that's interesting, but why would you do that? You must be looking for gold. That kind of thing. And the next day, or the next few days, we could have people coming up with big swords and threatening us. And on one famous occasion, in the year one or year two, I can't remember now, we were visited by a big white pickup with Saudi Arabian number plates and blacked out windows, clearly watching us. And we then were told that there was a threat there, because we were obviously sort of Europeans or Western people in this area, in this volatile time, and the whole Marne area where it happened was very fundamentalist in Islam. And we then had to have interviews with the local governor, local police chief, and local secret services, to perhaps buy some kind of, not buy in terms of money, but to arrange for some kind of clandestine observation and protection. So that faded away after a few years, but to begin with, it was very much that we were doing conflict archaeology in the middle of an ongoing conflict, and were being directly confronted by that.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saunders, for this presentation and sharing your rich experiences with this project. And for those of you who were able to tune in, thank you so much for doing so. Have a great rest of your weekend and take care.
Thank you.